So if you have Bibles today, I'm going to ask you to turn to 2 Corinthians 5:21. I'm going to hang out on that verse today, but I want to build us up to that real quick. And then I just hope today brings some clarity to mind as we continue to talk about this idea of holiness. And so I want to hang out on 2 Corinthians 5:21 and just see if we can't continue to uncover this idea of what holiness is. 2 weeks ago, if you haven't been with us or you missed a week or whatever, 2 weeks ago we started to walk through this concept of holiness and we discovered that it is in fact for us. Remember, the idea of that was holiness is for you. I asked you that question and I want to tell you, if you are a Christian, holiness is for you. That is not an option. Because we talked about that last week, right? And for the Christian, for the person that believes in Jesus Christ, holiness is not an option. And so what we get now is this tension of this cultural idea of what holiness looks like. And we think that in order to be holy, you have to look like a nun, or you have to participate in certain things and not participate in other things. And while some of those things may have, so like looking like a nun, dressing like a nun, and doing, you know, long, very modest conservative dress and everything like that, while that may have a part and a purpose in our pursuit of holiness, that is not what makes us holy. If that makes any sense. And I hope I can explain that today in a way that is going to just bring the gospel into full view and is also going to explain and hopefully turn your heart away from the idea that deeds are going to save you and move you into affection for the Lord. So in the first week, we looked at what holiness is and what it wasn't. Holiness isn't simply an action or outward appearance. Holiness is much, much more than that. It's absolutely much, much more than that. It actually involves our motives, our thoughts, our actions, our attitudes, pretty much everything about who we are, our identity. God demands that we be holy if we are associated with Him. He demands it. We're His children. If we say we are Christian, we have been justified and adopted. That's what happens in salvation, is that we are justified before Him. That's a legal term, meaning that we're declared innocent before God. We'll talk about that a little bit today. And we are adopted into His family. What happens when you're adopted into a family? You take their name, right? You take their name. You are now under their authority, those parents that would adopt you into that. And so what God does is said, welcome into the family. I am going to freely adopt you with whatever issues that you have. I'm going to bring you into this family, and I'm going to love you. And out of that love, hopefully there would be a response of transformation in that. And so in Leviticus 20:26, we read this. He says, you shall be holy to me. For I, the Lord, am holy and have separated you from the peoples that you should be mine. You shall be holy to me, for I, the Lord, am holy. And so right there, we see the reason that we are to be holy. It's not for the world. It's not for us. It's not for anything. It's for the Lord. Be holy, for I am holy, is what God says. And so we talked about the first week. Second week, we talked about the fact that holiness isn't an option. Hebrews 12:14. It says, strive for peace with everyone and for the holiness without which no one will see the Lord. We talked about that last week. And we skipped over the peace with everyone part. That's a very important component of that verse. But for what we were talking about last week, I just skipped over that part and just strive for the holiness without which no one will see the Lord. Strive for the holiness. And so what we learn is that there's absolutely action on our part. It's not just a come to church thing and let Jesus cleanse us of all unrighteousness. It's a, what are we going to do in response to that? And so we're here, we're to strive for holiness on our own, and it's not really an optional thing. And so far, we're in this series, we're doing this for 3 months. We're going to cover this. I'm talking about this on Easter, and it's going to line up perfectly. It's going to be awesome. And the kids are in next week, which is also means that I get to do some really fun stuff with them. So it's going to be fun for everyone. I'm excited about this. But we're taking 3 months on this, and we're going right through because we need this. We need to pay attention to this. And I'm still setting the foundation. Today is the capstone. It is the cornerstone of this entire thing. And if today's message, if you do not believe what is in today, if you do not understand this, then the whole gospel begins to fall apart. It's the linchpin of it all. Your faith begins to just deteriorate from the outside in or inside out. Because without this, really, you have nothing. And so we're still in the foundational phase. And so I hope that you've got a grasp on what holiness is and what it isn't. We understand that it's not an option. And today I want to lay this cornerstone, because after today the whole building begins to start to come together. We begin to understand and we begin to see the shape of what's going on. And so I want to read this verse I had you look up. 2 Corinthians 5:21. It says, "For our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." Now, when we're studying Scripture, sometimes we just need to take it in bite-sized chunks, right? And so I just want to start with those first three words, "for our sake." Whatever the implications of this verse are, whatever the outcome is, it's for us. It's for our sake. So when I say to someone, or when you say to someone, "for your sake, you better forgive that person. For your sake, you better not touch that hot stove." Right? "For your sake, you better not drink that bottle of Coke." Just seeing if you're paying attention. "For your sake, I hope you're telling the truth." You ever heard that one before? So, for whose sake? It's not for my sake. If I'm saying that, it's not for my sake. It's not for the other person, right? If you got to forgive somebody, it's not for their sake that you forgive them, is it? It's for your sake. The primary purpose of this is for you. It's for you that you should do these things. It's not for the good of the other person to forgive them. It's for your good. It's not for the good of anyone else other than yourself not to touch a hot stove, right? It's not for your good to tell the truth. It is for your good to tell the truth, that you might not be labeled a liar, that you might resolve whatever situation you're in. So whatever happens in this verse, it's for us. It's for our sake. So let's go on to the next. "He made him to be sin who knew no sin." Here's the meat and potatoes right here. Let me put the nouns in the place of this verse, all right? God made Jesus to be sin, though Jesus knew no sin. So this is the power of the verse and the power of the gospel, because let's talk about Jesus for a second, all right? He knew no sin. In other words, he didn't sin. He didn't know what sin was. He didn't understand it intimately. And so this is a universal teaching of the Scriptures. I want you to understand this. You don't just find this in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, where they just talk about primarily Jesus' life. This is a universal teaching of the Scriptures. In Hebrews 4:15, Jesus is talking about Jesus here. "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin." So Jesus was tempted in every single way that we are, yet was without sin. And so we're not 100% positive. Scholars are total, and not in total disagreement, but there is some debate as to who wrote Hebrews. But generally it is attributed to the Apostle Paul. And it was written about 67 to 69 AD. 1 Peter 2:22 says, "He committed no sin." Jesus committed no sin. "Neither was deceit found in his mouth." He never lied. He never tried to deceive anyone. That's what that verse would say. And so we would know that Peter wrote 1 Peter around AD 60. In the verse that we're studying, 2 Corinthians 5:21, "For our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that we might become the righteousness of God." 2 Corinthians is attributed to Apostle Paul, written somewhere around AD 50 to AD 70. And in about AD 90, John writes this in 1 John 3:5, "You know that he appeared in order to take away sins, and in him there is no sin." Written around 700 BC, now we're going back in time. Isaiah writes in 53:11, "Out of the anguish of his soul," prophetically talking, "he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities." Righteousness means what? Holy. Without sin. Morally blameless, that he would be righteous. And so the righteous one, or the perfect one, sinless one. And then in Psalm 45:7, probably written by David around 1,000, the Psalms were written over a span of time by a couple different authors. So generally they were written between 1,000 BC and 400 BC. And this was talking prophetically about Jesus. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. And so we see multiple authors. There's more examples in the scriptures, but you see multiple authors over the span of 1,000 years. Over 1,000 years have all written about the fact that Jesus is sinless and perfect, that there would be a Messiah, that there would be someone who would be morally blameless according to God's law and would be able to live a life perfectly. And so what I'm trying to show you by just going through this real quick is that Jesus lived up to this claim. Both there was prophecy, it proves that there was the plan. And then we see the aftermath after Jesus was crucified and rose again. We see that it was confirmed. Jesus lived up to the claim. Jesus was holy. He is holy, which means that Jesus was morally blameless. He lived in complete conformity to the moral precepts of the Bible and in complete contrast to the world, which means he knew no sin and did no wrong. And I got to be honest with you, this is hard for us to imagine, isn't it? I see a little picture floating around on the internet of a little baby over a bathtub, water, and he's standing on top of the water, and it's supposed to be Jesus. And Mary, his mother, is sitting there and saying, Jesus, in the water, and he's standing with his arms crossed saying, no. He doesn't want bath time, right? It's kind of cute. But unfortunately, it's wrong. Thou shalt honor your mother and your father. If he disobeyed his mother, sin, right? Yeah. Jesus knew no sin. He knew temptation. Absolutely knew temptation. He knew no sin. And so this is where the train starts going off the tracks for some of you, because you're like, how can that be? How is that even possible that a human being would never lie, would never cheat, would never steal, would never do some of these things? How can this be? And this is why the virgin birth that we talk about at Christmas time is so important, because the sinful nature that is a part of our being wasn't a part of Jesus's being. And so I don't know the mechanics of it. All I can tell you is that half the DNA that made up Jesus Christ was not from a human source. It was not from a human source. So half from a human, half a miracle of God. And so while Jesus was fully human, he was also fully God. And it blows our minds, because we learned in math class that you can't have 100% of something and also 100% of something else, right? So this is the logic that defies our minds. This is where we go, that we have to just kind of sit back and go, God's ways are not our ways. We can't understand this. Like, as an animal doesn't understand logic and reasoning as we do, we are in the same boat. There is a jump that is made from our level of logic and reasoning to the God's level of logic and reasoning. And so while Jesus was fully human, he was also fully God, and he experienced every temptation that we've ever experienced. And though he experienced it, he never walked from temptation into sin. Jesus knew no sin. He was familiar with temptation, but up until the cross, he wasn't intimately familiar with the separation and the pain and the shame and the anguish and the chaos that sin causes. We would not be here today if Jesus knew sin before the cross. And so please listen to me. If you believe that Jesus couldn't have been perfect, that at some point he lusted, at some point he lied, at some point he had some selfish motivation, if he gossiped, then anything you believe about the Bible is but a house built on sand. If you deep down in your heart cannot accept the fact that Jesus was sinless, then whatever faith construct that you have built is simply built to make you feel better. If Jesus sinned, then there is no logical argument for believing that you have a Savior and you might as well have slept in this morning. Because here's how this works. The wrath of God burns against sinners, of which we all in this room and every other human being that has ever walked the planet fit into that definition. Amen? We all fit in that definition. We're there. All right? So Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Sin is simply an offense toward God. We can look at it like we look at treason today. No, God, I know that you've said that this is the way that the world works and this is how you would have me be. I understand that this is how you want me to live my life. And I understand that I live in your universe that you created. But I'm going to do things my way. And we in our minds and through our actions dethrone God, walk out of submission to Him to establish our own kingdom inside of His, right? If I wanted to live my own way inside of the United States of America, if I wanted to drive 90 on the highway, if I wanted to take whatever you want to do. There's many different things that you can go. And all of them just not good. If you decide to live your own way, if you decide to establish your own kingdom within the United States of America, what's going to happen? You can build your own army if you want to. You can mount a resistance, but the full weight of the U.S. military is at some point going to come down on you and crush you, right? Because you are acting in treason. And treason in most countries today is still punishable by death. And so it is not outrageous for us to understand this because we would treat each other in this fashion. That if we walk out of submission to our government, to our God, to the established authority, there's a problem. There is an offense and there will be anger. And so why is it that we believe we can do this? Why do you sit there and think that you can lie to your friends, to your coworkers, to other Christians? Why is it that you think you can gossip? Why is it that you entertain all kinds of lust in your mind, committing adultery with someone in your heart? Why is it that you serve yourself above serving others? Jeremiah 17:9 tells us that the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately sick. Who can understand it? And your heart is wicked. Mark 7:21 would tell us that from within, out of the heart of man, come evil thoughts. And then he goes on to list some of the evil things that can be done out of the heart of man. And so we sin. Our heart is deceitful. And so it lies to us and says, yeah, you can establish your own kingdom. You don't have to hurt anybody. You can do what you want. God can't stop you. Isn't there a higher calling than just to be righteous? Isn't there a higher calling than to make people feel bad by the way that you live your life? Isn't love and peace what we all want? Yeah, it is. It really is. But unfortunately, trying to get to love and peace through sin will always cause chaos. Always. And so we sin because we don't have this accurate view of ourselves. Listen to me. We do this because we don't understand what's going on in our own hearts. What we walk around believing is that we bought into this idea that we are generally good people. We look at other people that are walking out in the streets, and we look at people who are just wrapped up in their sin, who are completely addicted to their sin, have had no way out, and we look at them and go, yeah, I'm better than that person. I'm a good person. And to you, honestly, what I would say is, no, you might be a good citizen, but I'm not sure you're a good person, according to what the Bible says. Does that make sense? That you're a good citizen. You do things not in order not to break the law, in order that you wouldn't face punishment. You do things in order to maintain relationships with other people. You do things in order that you might keep a job And so you contribute to society, you contribute to the peace that we all need to work together for the good of the whole. But if we are to hold this as the, if we are to hold our scripture as superior authority in our lives, then what this says is that our heart lies, it is sick, it is ill, and from it comes all kinds of evil. And so what we deserve as sinners, as wicked people, is death. Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The payment of sin is death. The act of treason, this offense of God, deserves death. And so you can't pay your way. You can't become good enough in order to be approved by God at some point. You've already sinned. When you stole a cookie from the cookie jar after your parents told you no, you sinned. You disobeyed them. The moment that a lie escapes from your mouth, you've sinned. Payment is death. And the only hope that we have is the innocence of something or someone else sacrificed. It's blood shed for us. Hebrews 9:22 says, in fact, the law, Old Testament law, requires that nearly everything be cleansed with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. In the Old Testament, God made a way with animal sacrifice. He made a way that their sins could be covered. And a lot of people just relate that to cultic actions, and it simply seems extreme, especially in a day when we consider animals parts of our families, right? I mean, it automatically creates this aversion in our hearts that just stirs up inside of us, and we're like, no, I don't like that. Why would I do that? The thought of putting your pet on an altar to be sacrificed immediately makes us recoil. And that's exactly the reaction it should have, because that's exactly how serious our sin is. The wages of sin is death. Every time you go to God and you ask, pleading for the forgiveness of sins, you know what authorizes that forgiveness? You know when you swipe your credit card at the store and it goes authorized? At some point, MasterCard, Visa, Discover, American Express, somebody said, yeah, they've got money in the bank, they're good to go. So you can authorize that transaction, right? You don't, just because you have a credit card doesn't mean that you got free money, right? We've learned that lesson, some of us. There is an authorizing agent. Every time we approach the Lord asking for forgiveness, do you know what the authorization is for that? The blood of Jesus. The death of Jesus. It's not just a free thing. The wrath of God had to be satisfied. Someone had to die for your sin, for that stupid lie that you told the other day, for that gossip that comes flying out of your mouth, for that lust that was in your mind, for those thoughts of just wanting to get your hands around somebody's neck and just choke the life out of them. For real. That is the weight of your sin. You've been to a funeral, right? You've lost someone close to you at some point in your life, right? You realize what caused that death. Do you understand? This is not just a part of life. Death didn't exist before sin. And like what we just go, yeah, it's just life. It's just the way life works. And you know, it's unfortunate, but that's the way things go. People get sick, they get old, they die. That's life, right? That's the cycle of life. Well, that's not what God created. That's not the cycle of life. That is, we've got to get out of our minds. We've got to get out of this from what we believe. And we have to look into the scripture, and we have to understand. You realize that death is caused by sin. You realize that sin causes those tears. It causes those desperate feelings of loss and panic and worry and constant sadness that this person is no longer a part of our lives. Sin caused death. It caused chaos. And so our only hope is innocence. that something or someone that would spill their blood, covering the wrongs that we've done, taking our place and satisfying the wrath of God. And so if Jesus wasn't sinless, if Jesus wasn't holy, then he can't be that sacrifice. If he sinned, if he disobeyed, if he lusted, if he lied, if he gossiped, if he didn't do what God wanted him to do in that moment, he would have knew sin and been doomed to death just like the rest of us. But when we have come to a saving faith in Jesus Christ, we admit two things. That I understand that I am a sinner who is absolutely incapable of saving myself from my own actions and my own sinful desires. And that we believe that Jesus can save us, starting the day that we believed, causing transformation in our minds, in our hearts, and all the while until the day that we walk into glorious light. Why would we believe that Jesus can save us from death? We were talking this morning about donut holes that are over there. And when I was a kid, there used to be a guy that the churches used called the Donut Man. And it was a corny level of entertainment for us kids to teach us the gospel and everything like that. And there was a little puppet donut that would talk, and it was really dumb. I'm just going to be honest. But we loved it. And the whole concept was that the donut had a hole in his heart that only a donut hole could fill. It was a simple illustration. And so I grew up with that thought, this idea that people will say that, well, my heart has a Jesus-shaped hole that only Jesus can fill. How many of you have heard that saying before? Yeah, a few of you. And so we grow up, and that is like if somebody walks up to you and asks you about your faith, why you believe what you believe, do you know how ridiculous you sound when you say, I have a Jesus-shaped hole in my heart that only He can fill? I'll see you in kindergarten tomorrow too, right? That's kind of the way that it is, right? Some of our answers to some of these things are really kind of ridiculous because we don't actually understand the foundation that's going on here. Why can Jesus save us from our sins? Because God made Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin. On a cross. And at that moment on Calvary, we get this picture of darkness in the earth. If you go back and read the account, we get Jesus crying out in Matthew 27, 46, my God, why have you forsaken me? And these things are clues to a separation that Jesus never knew from his Father. From his God, that God made a righteous man into sin, taking on the sin of all people for all time. And the only reason he was able to do that was because he was, in fact, holy and sinless. And so not long after this, Jesus yields up his spirit, taking sin to the grave with him. And then 3 days later, a miraculous masterstroke of genius and glory, Jesus picks his life back up again in the resurrection because there was no sin in him. And there was no deserved death. His death was given over in place of ours that we might inherit eternal life in the Lord. 1 Corinthians 15, 55. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? And this is only possible because Jesus was, in fact, holy. So we go back to our verse. The last part of that was that we might become the righteousness of God. That you and I might become the righteousness of God. So for our sake, He made Him who knew no sin to be sin, that we might become the righteousness of God. So now, if we confess a faith in Jesus Christ, and respond to His selfless sacrifice of His love with a selfless sacrifice of our own, giving our lives over to Him, then we are justified and adopted, and we become the righteousness of God. Justified meaning, again, being declared innocent, righteous, and holy before our God. And adopted meaning that your family now, take my name. I will treat you as if you were my own. I will love you as if you were my own. And I will discipline you as if you are my own. So you're a child of God, and God is the ultimate Father. Some of you have had really terrible dads. He's not representative of those men. God is one who always loves in the fullest and most complete definition of the word, and is constantly looking out for your well-being, second only to His glory. And so what we find is that a life of holiness is not just about being good or doing good things. What we have what is called imputed righteousness. Righteousness that has been ascribed, or it has been attributed to us. Not because of what we've done or will do, but because of what Jesus has already accomplished. The death, burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, His taking on the sins of the world, our sins, would build a bridge that could cross back over to God the Father in heaven. He has made a way that we can engage in a relationship with the Lord again, one that had not been possible for thousands of years. And now we can approach the Lord in prayer. We can be guided by His Spirit that's promised to us. And we can read about His provision, and we can have hope today that He will deliver us from evil. And so here's the hope that we have in the gospel of Jesus Christ. It doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter what sin you've already committed. There's only one unforgivable sin, and that is blasphemy of the Holy Spirit, which pretty sure most of you probably haven't done in that, especially if you're going, I don't know what that is. You pretty much haven't done it. But it doesn't matter what you've done, because here's the truth that you need to embrace. And I've been talking about every week, is your identity is not what you've done. Your identity is not what you've done. Hebrews 10:7 is Jesus is talking in this. He says, I've come to do your will, O God. And so there's absolutely an actionable component of holiness. There's absolutely a part on us. We talked about it a little bit last week. We're going to talk about more. But there is absolutely a part of us that needs to strive for holiness, an effort to put forth. But you've got to get angry about your sin. You've got to be upset with the fact that you can't do anything but sin. You've got to be angry with that. You got to encounter this fire and frustration in your own heart. You've got to feel the fact that the sin that you commit, no matter how big nor how small, is the sin that brought forth death and chaos into this world. That sin has brought forth pain. That sin has brought forth sadness. That sin has brought forth chaos. And you've got to be broken about the fact that you are utterly incapable of escaping it, because let's be honest, you like it. We've heard it said that if sin felt like a root canal, nobody would participate in it. Right? We like it. And so while we assemble week after week after week, while we look at each other in the eye and we hope that we're all good people, we have to look at each other in the eyes and know that the heart is deceitful and it is sick. And none of us can understand it. And so our minds come into this place and we want to worship the Lord. We want to be good people. We want to live up to this standard. We want to be with God someday. We want to worship Him. We want to say, "You are holy. I will love You for the rest of my days." We're going to sing all these songs, and we're going to be happy about that, and we're going to express it, and we're going to be emotional about it. And you're going to shout, "Amen." But the minute you walk out, you're going to be an onslaught of your sinful nature, and at some point, you're going to lie because you think it's better for you if you lie, and at some point, you're going to be gossiping because you like to tell people information, and you love that feeling of seeing their jaw drop on their face. And you're going to look at someone, you're going to be like, "Man, I wish I had that in my bedroom." And you're going to look at other things, you're going to do all these things because you like it. Let's be honest about that. And that should frustrate you to no end. If you are in a passionate pursuit of the Lord, you should be angry about that. That you would echo the statements of the Apostle Paul, "I do what I don't want to do, and yet I don't do what I know I want to do." The bottom line is that we like to do the very things that put Jesus on the cross. And realizing that should bring you into this place. Honestly, nobody likes this, but it should bring you into this place of feeling small, feeling humbled, feeling so incredibly responsible. But where we are tempted to run and to hide from our God, the person with faith in Jesus Christ instead runs to Jesus. Because that's why He died. Because He came here and He understood the onslaught. He understood the sin. He understood that our heart is sick. He understands what we are going through. And out of an incredible love that none of us will ever be able to understand fully in this life, He embraced the will of the Lord that would send Him to a cross, that He would be put to death, that His blood would be spilled out for all, that He would be sacrificed for our sins. That's why He died, so that you could have hope. And so listen to me. The holy life, living in holiness, being holy, is not primarily about being perfect. Living the holy life is not primarily about being perfect. It's just not possible. And for some reason, there's a real danger that you'll never find rest in the Lord because you're pursuing perfection and you're never going to get there. No, the holy life isn't about perfection. The holy life is about being broken over our imperfections. Generations of Christians have proven that you can go to church, that you can read the Bible, and you can pray, and you can never actually feel the weight of your sin. And they just end up covering up their sins. They never call others out on their sins. They never spur one another on toward love and good deeds. They don't point the finger, and they know if they do that many more are going to be pointed back because we don't talk about our sins. But here's the thing, if you're broken over your sin, if we live in this understanding that your heart is wicked, that my heart is wicked, that out of the heart comes evil things, that the heart is sick, if you understand this, then when your brother or your sister falls into sin, you can look at them and go, "I don't understand it, but I'm going to lock arms with you, I'm going to pick you up, and we're going to walk together." Amen. Do you understand that that is the power of the gospel, that we don't look at you and go, "Yeah, you're out of the race. Sorry, we're going to keep going. We're going to leave you behind now because you fell." Nuh-uh. We leave no man behind. We leave no one behind. We lock arms and we walk together We stop when someone falls. We preach to those who fall. We surround them with love when they fall. We give of our money and our resources and of our time when they fall. We do not level judgments against them as the world does. But for some reason, we are weak in this. Our culture is weak in this because we love justice. And we love to see people pay for what they've done. But if you're broken over your sin, if you understand that your sin killed an innocent man and spilled innocent blood, then you understand that the face of God is hidden from you because you've chosen sin. And then you will never respond flippantly. If you understand those things, you will never just be flippant about this idea of grace. You'll never be like, yeah, I got grace, so I'm just going to go out and have a good time. Not going to do that. You're never going to look at someone else and go, yeah, they're a liar, but it's okay. That's just the way they are. No, you're going to be like, dude, I want you to see Jesus someday. We're not going to do this together. You will understand God's grace. You will worship the Lord out of an extreme love because you know what it took to bring you before God. And your heart will automatically begin to line up with the heart of God. And you will follow in Jesus' footsteps, unlocking the key to holiness, doing the will of the Lord. And so it's the holiness that Jesus was able to act out, and not just in deed, but also in his mind. The fact that he was sinless. That he wanted what the Lord wanted. And even when he knew what he was up against in the Garden of Gethsemane, when he was sweating blood, even though he wanted to change the plan, God said, no, this is my will. And Jesus submitted to it and fulfilled what God wanted. We don't live by the will of the Lord so that we can be declared a holy people. Listen, we are declared a holy people by the imputed righteousness of Christ, by the ascribed righteousness of God. And so in response to that incredible gift of love, that incredible act of love, we should be compelled to be a holy people. Does that make sense? We got it backwards sometimes. I got to do more. I got to be better. I got to look better. I got to stop sinning. No. You need to be broken over your sin. You need to understand what Jesus has done for you. He gave his life for you. And out of that love, let it move you away from your sin. Let it transform the wicked, lying heart that you have into a life of complete righteousness.